I'm Jeff Yarger. I'm a professor of chemistry, biochemistry, and physics at Arizona State University. This video today, we're going to cover the first part of Atkins' Physical Chemistry for the Life Sciences. He has a section on fundamentals, basically the concepts that you would normally see in introductory chemistry and physics is kind of some background and introduction before we get into thermodynamics for the life sciences. And it's a really good review of material that you've seen in the past and a condensed version of some basic concepts and constants, equations, etc. for this. Again, you can reach me at yarger@biopchem.education, and a lot of the material, I have a general website called biopchem.education where a lot of these videos, other ancillary material will be posted. And this is a current version of the book cover. I have one with the older one, but this is edition 2 of Physical Chemistry for the Life Sciences. So in this, we've looked at kind of an introduction to this, and what we're looking at now is this fundamentals, which is basically the first 20 pages, like I said, kind of some background material. Before we get into the first part of this book, which is looking at biochemical thermodynamics. And there we're going to try to basically make an overview video for each of the individual chapters. And so today we're just going to be looking at this fundamentals chapter. So it's split into three components. The first one is reminding you of very introductory chemistry as far as what atoms are, how atoms go to form molecules, what ions are by whether they have fewer or more electrons, etc., how you kind of draw some of these, reminding you of from the very simple things like basic water, organic molecules, etc., you know, how you do kind of these atom by atom molecular diagrams, how you get to more sophisticated things, things that you would see typically in organic chemistry, where you no longer kind of show the carbons, they're at the vertices of each of these, but you show kind of the bonding structure and sometimes the heteroatoms. To, as you get towards more biological systems, you often get to where they show this kind of ball stick type of model. And they even try to do, you know, kind of the balls to indicate kind of size, color to indicate the atom type, et cetera, the number of sticks to indicate single bonds, double bonds, et cetera. So it kind of shows some of that for something like a basic amino acid where this R group, which is something you see in organic chemistry, changes for the different, say, for example, 20 primary amino acids, how these would link up through a peptide bond. So this would form multiple. This is how you link amino acids to form peptides and ultimately to proteins. Also some other basic molecules like in this case, deoxyribophosphate. It also shows basic sugar molecules, et cetera, in this kind of ball stick configuration. Now, as you kind of go from the small, just a few atoms in a compound or a molecular structure and kind of its electronic structure format, what are covalent bonds, what are, lone pair electrons, etc. So all kind of reminding you of things you've seen in an introductory chemistry course. And it moves on from these kind of ball stick molecules, which I've shown from the last slide, to looking at really as you move towards biochemical systems. And so oftentimes here, the number of atoms and number of bonds and get so large that they show these with even kind of higher order structures. And for example, in something like proteins, where you often have, you know, thousands and tens of thousands of atoms, because you often have hundreds to thousands of amino acids that are all linked together as a polymer. And so these representations don't show the individual atoms or in a sense something that's showing kind of at the very molecular level. It's showing one grade up from that. So where it's basically showing the backbone of it. So you can see the helical background. So the primary structure, each of these balls would indicate, for example, an amino acid. The secondary structure is how those amino acids are templating three-dimensional space, in this case, in a helical type format. Tertiary structure is looking at the overall three-dimensional shape of a protein or peptide or large macromolecule. And then these quaternary structures are oftentimes, especially in things like proteins, it's often there's a single unit, but those form multiple units of them. For example, one of them, it's not just one, it will have like a dimer. Or in the case shown here, this structure repeats four different times. And so there's four of these monomer units that forms this tetramer type structure. And that, the overall tetramer structure of that is its overall quaternary structure. So you go to these kind of hierarchical levels of looking at the structure as you move towards these more complicated and larger biological molecules. And then it gives examples. This is specifically in the polymers of amino acids. It also shows things in, for example, polymers of nucleic acids. So, you know, RNA, DNA, this is DNA in this case, and how it builds from the molecular level up to, you know, these higher order secondary structures, tertiary structures, et cetera. And then it also shows another important class of molecules, in this case, things like lipids, and these lipids that go to form lipid bilayers, where they often use this kind of circular head group, as they're often called, to indicate kind of the polar region, and these squiggly tail lines, in this case, each of them have two, to indicate the non-polar region and how these things kind of template in three-dimensional space, whether they form these kind of bilayer type structures as shown here, or whether they form micelles, et cetera. And so it's often shown at this level when you get to biochemistry, molecular biology, et cetera. And so this is kind of part one, is kind of taking you from the basic chemistry and kind of reminding you where we're heading in this direction. Part two of the fundamentals is reminding us of kind of some bulk properties of matter. And so, you know, oftentimes we start here with gas laws, the ideal gas law, and looking at kind of units for pressure, volume, making sure we can convert between them what standard states are. And as you can see, it gives quite a few tables in there. It also focuses on a key aspect that we're going to get to in part one of this book, which is equilibrium and what it is to have mechanical equilibrium versus thermal equilibrium in a system. And we're going to be spending a lot of time. Equilibrium is a key concept that we need to introduce in thermodynamics. And so it kind of reminds you of that introductory level here, as well as just some very important things. I would never underestimate. In fact, the number one thing I often see students miss on when they're being evaluated in physical chemistry is often conversion of units and just, you know, kind of doing the simple arithmetic right. But unit conversions, you know, often plague a lot of this. So to kind of make sure that we kind of see some basic units and how to convert between them, you know, in both the temperature, pressure scale and things we're used to is very useful, as well as converting between different units of for example, the gas constant here. And it introduces the ideal gas law and equations of state and other kind of fundamental concepts of kind of bulk matter, solid, liquid, gas, physical states of matter. Then the third and final kind of subsection in this fundamentals component is really looking at energy. And energy is really going to be the key concept that really is at the heart of what we're going to look at in physical chemistry, both in thermodynamics. Often 9 times out of 10, what we end up looking at is some type of energy changes, chemical energy changes, mechanical changes, thermal changes that all change energies. even quantum mechanics, it's typically expressed in energy units, whether we're in the statistical mechanics and kinetics in between. So energy is really a fundamental concept, and it's given a lot of time of kind of review at this. So starting with some very fundamental physics and chemistry that we often see, which is the energy of photons of light or the electromagnetic spectrum, and reminding us of kind of some basics here, how energy is related to the frequency of the light, nu here, through a constant, or its wavelength by the speed of light, and a constant called Planck's constant. And it, reminding you just kind of intuitively of where, you know, the huge range of electromagnetic spectrum, its kind of general wavelengths, and some types of spectroscopy that we use in chemistry to probe molecules, and what kind of frequency or wavelength range they're in. And then energy goes on to look at it kind of from a microscopic or molecular standpoint, which again is another tenet in physical chemistry, is that looking at things kind of from this molecular level and building up some of our molecular understanding. And so not just, for example, looking at the energy as a whole, but looking at it, breaking it up into kind of different degrees of freedom. It's electronic degrees of freedom, vibrational degrees of freedom, and internal how it's moving, its rotational degrees of freedom, and then how it can translate or move through three-dimensional space, and how some of these relate to energy, and how the gas constant relates to the Boltzmann constant through the Avogadro's number, which we often go between when we talk about macroscopic gas systems. We often use the gas constant, but in most other cases, we end up using the Boltzmann constant when looking at a lot of this. And so that's very helpful. And then it uses, you know, this to kind of even remind us of a common example kind of at the molecular level, looking at the kinetic theory of gases or the molecular motion in gases and how those change, for example, when you change temperature, in this case, how the distribution and average speed changes, and what some of this looks like, as well as if you changed, you know, the, in a sense, the molar mass or the weight, you know, the mass of a gas molecule, and how that could have, you know, the same effect on the overall distribution of speed and average speed that particles can have. And so kind of thinking of this bulk property from a microscopic standpoint. So, and then finally, it gives a interlude and shows a mathematical concept that is really critical when we're looking at both thermodynamics, statistical mechanics, kinetics, et cetera. And so in this case, the mathematical lesson it shows you in the beginning is showing you exponential functions and how those exponentials are used to define Gaussian type distributions or symmetric peak type functions. And really this is, I would say, another real critical aspect in physical chemistry that we're gonna use a fair amount of mathematics kind of at both the algebra level, both the graphical level as far as plotting it, you know, geometry levels to understand things, and then calculus, the change in variables, you know, et cetera, or how things change, you know, how energies change, you know, typically go as derivatives, you know, type things and their associated integrals. So this is a first thing, and I really, I think they, you know, a good job is, and one thing that can really help learn this is to plot some of these functions using your favorite software or spreadsheet program yourself, and make sure you can reproduce some of this and you know the basic mathematical, which is the fundamental language we'll be using to describe all science in this course. So that gives you kind of an overview of this fundamentals first kind of chapter or first background material in Atkins' book. And we'll be making overview videos for each of the chapters within this text as well. Thank you.